Welcome to this sci-fi panel examining the digital Indo-Pacific and emerging tech agenda for the Quad. We're going to be looking at whether it's time for the Quad to chart a roadmap for its longer-term engagement with emerging technology issues, some of the immediate areas of achievable consensus, and how the grouping should integrate itself and its vision into the web of existing architectures in the Indo-Pacific. I'm Fergus Hansen, one of the directors at the Australian Strategic Policy Institute, and I'm delighted to be moderating this panel today from Canberra. I'm also delighted to be doing this as part of a joint initiative between SciFi and the Sydney Dialogue. We jointly chose today's panel topic as a preview for the Sydney Dialogue, which ASPE is convening and which will be kicking off on 17 November next month. We've got some wonderful speakers, including the Indian Prime Minister, so I hope many of you will be able to join us for that event too. We also have an outstanding panel of distinguished speakers lined up today, who can each offer a unique perspective from one of the Quad countries. We have Vindu Chotani, Adjunct Lecturer at the College of International Relations, Raisimikan Asia Pacific University, Tarun Chabra, Senior Director for Technology and National Security, the White House National Security Council, Raji Rajagopalan, Director, Center for Security, Strategy and Technology at the Observer Research Foundation, and Tobias Feakin, Ambassador for Cyber Affairs and Critical Technology at the Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. Thank you to each of our panel members for giving their time to join this discussion, and thank you all for joining us and giving up your time to join this important discussion today. Let me get straight into the questions. I wanted to start by sense checking what the appetite is really like in each of the four Quad countries for developing a roadmap for the Quad's longer term engagement with emerging technology issues, and maybe more broadly, what the vision is in each country for the Quad. So I was wondering if I could just ask each of our panel members just to offer their short perspective from each of their countries. And maybe I can start off with you, Vindu.
Thank you very much, and a very good evening to everyone. Good afternoon, good morning to you joining us today. So what I want to do here is give a brief analysis of Japan's evolution to the Quad in order to understand the kind of roadmap we can expect from Japan. I think it's fair to state, you know, Japan was the primary proponent of the Quad in 2006-07, you know, moving forward with the QSD. So when the idea kind of was reproposed by then Foreign Minister Kono in October 2017, the framework was essentially focused on security, primarily because there was a convergence of views by the Quad states regarding China. So for Japan, the Quad became increasingly complementary with its free and open Indo-Pacific strategy at that time. Yet it was around the same time in 2017 and 18 when Japan-China relations really started to warm up. So while I do understand the concern regarding Chinese behavior, the increasing assertiveness, I do also recognize the importance of China for Japan, especially on the economic front. So against this backdrop, when I study the Quad and how it's been evolving, and not just in terms of, you know, the growing level of seniority in meetings or the frequency of meetings, but more in terms of its nature and scope, for Japan, I would argue two things here, which could actually be good for the Quad states themselves and Japan moving forward. The first is that Japan should continue to work to deepen and strengthen its ties with Quad states through this more multi-layered security cooperation. And we see it doing a lot of that, you know, focusing on hard security issues such as the South China Sea and East China Sea, and a big win for Japan being the inclusion of, you know, the North Korean denuclearization in the summit statement in September 2021. But secondly, and I think this is a lot more new and also more important at this stage, is we do see newer areas of engagement, especially from the 2021 September summit. That is, we are moving forward towards a framework that provides public goods to the region rather than just solely security. And in this increasing scope, you know, to include critical and emerging tech issues such as AI and 5G, we see Japan actually playing an important role. And I think what this also does is lend a bit more balance to Japan to the Quad, wherein it can continue to support the Quad states, you know, in addressing the key security issues, while also continuing to maintain its relationship with China by pursuing its policy of the Seiki Bunri, where it essentially balances and separates politics and economics. So all in all, I would say this expanding nature of the quad and this roadmap going forward, I think will be very well received by Japan. And we can expect to see a very continued and very proactive Japan in the coming months.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Vindu. Toby, could I pass to you next?
Absolutely, Fergus, and thanks very much for having me on this panel today. I think, you know, it's interesting the proposition you say about, you know, can we work towards a roadmap for the quad? I mean, I would argue that we have one, and a pretty exciting one at that it is. And certainly I can report from being inside one of the members of the quad, the level of work is heightened and fast and meaningful. And what you see amongst the quad members is this broadening out of the involvement of a whole array of different levers of government to get involved in order that you can really start delivering, you know, getting the rubber hitting the road across a whole array of different areas. You know, look how practical the quad is being around vaccine rollout, 1.2 billion vaccines that the quad is rolling out across the region. The fact that it's cooperating across, you know, whether it be climate issues, tech issues, the array of issues that it's tackling, and in a meaningful fashion. And I, you know, commend anyone to go and have a look at the outcome statement, some of the working groups now that are now established. You know, I mean, I could go through them and list them, but the list is long. I mean, it's a, you know, tech horizon scanning. We're looking at semiconductor supply chains, cybersecurity uplift, standards coordination in technical standard setting bodies, value statements around tech. I mean, it is rich. I mean, I would argue, you know, try and find another kind of mini lateral, if you like, that is working so hard and has such a rich working program, which, you know, Tarun will talk to as well. He's been really at the epicenter of this, in making sure that it's practically driven outcomes that the quad can produce. And it's as important that we do that through the quad in tech as any other area. And you know, I'll preempt any, you know, maybe one question that might come up just to get ahead of myself on this front. You know, well, why should we have new mechanisms for looking at technology? Well, you know, if you're in the technology industry, you're not going to sit still and just, you know, follow the common lines of research and development yourself, are you? And likewise for governments, you know, finding architecture which is going to drive technology and the values that underpin it is absolutely vital. And I think you're seeing that through the quad and the level of energy and prioritization that all quad members now are giving this area of work.
Wonderful, thank you. I'll come to Tarun in a moment, but maybe I can go to Raji first for a perspective from India.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Fergus. And Vindu touched upon how the quad has evolved from 2006-07. Clearly, we have come a long way, and the appetite in each of the quad capitals could be better. The quad grouping, for instance, is located in an increasingly geopolitically turbulent region, a region that is characterized by mistrust, competition, rivalry, and insecurity. And this is, of course, a function of the changing balance of power in the Indo-Pacific and beyond. But of course, the most important thing is the spectacular rise of China, one that has been threatening everyone in the region and far. But this political problem is exacerbated by the technology-related developments, including its uneven availability, potential misuse, which could have implications for the larger strategic stability in the region. And the Quad countries are today concerned also about the global supply chain problems, recognizing again the vulnerability of their dependence, excessive dependence on China, which has become another important agenda for the Quad countries, including India, that has traditionally remained hesitant about joining such initiatives that are perceived as targeting China. But the Indian appetite in particular has gone through some important shifts, especially over the last couple of years. In the wake of the Galvan conflict that happened in 2020 summer, India recognizes and acknowledges the need for resilient, secure, diverse technology supply chains that have become so critical for future prosperity and stability in the Indo-Pacific. And of course, the arrival of new technologies such as artificial intelligence, robotics, machine learning, hypersonics, drones, and older ones such as the outer space or missile defense, all of this and the penetrating influence of telecommunication technologies such as 5G, for instance, these have serious consequences for the strategic dynamics, stability dynamics in the Indo-Pacific. And of course, most major power relations are today characterized by this technology competition, the US-China competition just being one example. But the geopolitical impact of the new technologies is becoming a compelling reality in the Indo-Pacific, including for India. So while technologies in general bring about prosperity and advancement in societies, in today's circumstances, they also have been a source of increasing competition and rivalry. And therefore, I would say, I think it's important that the Quad is looking at a number of different things. One, formulating, framing new rules and norms of responsible behavior, rules, guidelines, standards, and so on and so forth. Second, also to ensure that no one country is gaining coercive capabilities due to their technological advantages. And one can see this again playing out in the Indo-Pacific region, that is seeing both the use of this technology to penetrate and influence societies, and also to use the technology by some states to meet their political and strategic ends, including through political pressure in determining the technological choices that states make. So these do have long-term strategic consequences, but for certainly in the case of, you can see this play out more specifically in the context of the telecommunication technology choices states make, 5G case being one. These have been particularly problematic when you consider the absence of legitimate market competition play out in a sense, again a pursuit of pursuit as a result of China's efforts at using technology to in its strategic and economic toolkit. So I think given the kind of geopolitical churning in the Indo-Pacific and the technology security interface, Quad is making a strategic push to engage in emerging and as well as critical technologies, and Delhi appears to be ready to play the game, so to say. It's come a long way, but I think New Delhi is a lot more open to including working on framing new rules and new rules of the road in a sense.
Thank you so much, Raji. Tarun, Toby's placed you right at the very epicenter of the Quad deliberations and these discussions. Can you give us a perspective from Washington, where Washington stands on this and the viewpoint from there in terms of driving this forward with a long-term agenda on emerging tech policy?
Yeah, thanks, Fergus, and good evening to you all and good morning from Washington. It's really a pleasure to be here, and I love the structure of this panel. It's great to have Vindu and Raji here from outside our governments and Toby here from inside. It really speaks to the Quad and the openness with which we approached the Quad. You know, one of the first things we did was to set up a 1.5 dialogue when we were talking about telecommunications, and one of the things we want to do much more of is have more interaction with researchers and civil society and industry, and so it's very emblematic, I think, of our overall and very open approach. I very much appreciated Raji and Vindu's introduction, providing strategic and historical context for the Quad. I think that really sets up well Toby's comments about what has happened over the last 9 months. So, you know, that evolution, I think, you know, happened over the course of many years. Then if you fast forward to the last 9 months, as Toby mentioned just a moment ago, if you had said, you know, in December of 2020 that we would have had two Quad summits, right, by October, I think everyone would have laughed in your face, right? I mean, it's really an extraordinary thing, and it just speaks to the convergence on a whole range of issues, whether it's COVID or whether it's technology or climate issues. I think it's important to kind of keep that perspective in mind. I also very much agree with Toby's comment that we have developed a fairly ambitious roadmap, right? Certainly within our technology group and many of the others too, you know, setting up contact groups, right, on standards, I think on its face can sound like a talk shop, but let me say it's not. We have built an architecture of cooperation really over the last several months following the first virtual summit, where we now have government officials consulting very frequently with colleagues in civil society and industry, but who are convening on a very regular basis to talk about standards development in artificial intelligence, standards development in advanced telecommunications. When we say that we are working on semiconductor supply chain initiatives, there's very active work involving experts all the way up and down the semiconductor supply chain who are now convening on a regular basis. So it's no small feat just to build that architecture of cooperation. And from that, I think we can do much more. And I think now it's a very opportune time, I think, to hear from colleagues about what greater ambition we could have as we build out what we've already agreed to do. But I think all of us are very open to new ideas, both in terms of accelerating in the areas where we have made commitments, but also broadening out that agenda as well. And we're very keen to hear from everyone on that front.
Jerome, thank you so much for that. Well, getting to the actual ideas of how we take this forward, a lot of officials I've spoken to after the Quad Leaders meeting have pointed to the need to quickly pivot from the framing statements that the leaders have provided to making this something practical on the ground. And in the spirit of the 1.5 track that you mentioned, in May, CSIS, I think, published a short paper called Innovation with Allies, Practical Paths Forward. And it had several, I thought, quite good suggestions, one of which was minimizing bureaucratic and legal barriers between Quad and other core partners. I was just wondering, I want to get the panel's perspective on some of the practical mechanics that we could or that are likely to be explored to make this, the technology piece in particular, happen. And maybe I could start with you, Raji, for a think tank perspective on this.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. There is clearly a recognition of the bureaucratic hurdles in each of the countries and that are needed to be addressed very quickly for speedy implementation of the decisions taken by Quad member states. But it's not been easy, and the leaders in all the four countries, I think, need to make some very conscious decisions to diversify and partner with each other within the Quad grouping. And I think this is need to be done on a political kind of, the political leadership and the political will is so much more necessary, essential for this. Over the past year and a half, the vulnerabilities of excessive dependence on the single source China, for instance, has been recognized. But again, diversifying from China has not been easy. Vietnam, for instance, has been one of the biggest benefactors using the opportunities in the sector by tapping into business opportunities that were shifting out of China, in a sense. India was hoping to benefit and get a fair deal from this shift, but it's not been easy for countries like India due to the kind of institutional and bureaucratic hurdles that have come in the way that are in some sense insurmountable to circumvent in some sense. So this is where I would again emphasize the need for the political leadership of the Quad countries need to make some certain political decisions to nurture a habit of collaboration on the basis of conscious decision, because unfortunately, democracies like India will otherwise continue to have some difficulties in this regard. So unless there is a political leadership, that drive has to come from the top leadership, and that has to drive the process in a sense. But I think there is, in terms of the agenda, there is a lot that can be done. Like I said in the beginning, one is, of course, to look at the possible collaboration of the developing technologies. That's one set of issues, so that states that remain ill-disposed towards free societies do not gain an advantage in developing these critical technologies, whether it is in advanced computing, telecommunication technologies such as 5G, artificial intelligence are all good examples. And the second is in terms of global governance of these technologies and ensuring that the governance measures do not impede or hamper the rights of all states in pursuing their development trajectories. So we need new rules of the road. Either we frame new ones or at least revise and amend the existing rules, because without appropriate rules of the road, we are looking at the possibility of certain states defining the use of technology from a very narrow national perspective. So there is a certain amount of political imperative and security-driven concerns that are going to be driving the political leadership to take on a much more proactive role. But like in democracies, I would say it is not an easy process. It's easier to say this than getting things moving, actually. But India, in some sense, especially the last Quad statement, John Stephen talks about framing norms of responsible behavior, rules and regulations. This I see as something very remarkable, because India's typically positioning on technology and governance has come a long way from earlier being part of the G21, which is predominantly the NAM countries, non-alignment movement countries. New Delhi today stands with the Quad countries in determining or shaping the kind of how technology is developed, designed, governed, and used. And I think that's the, again, underlying the importance of democratic values, respect for universal human rights. So I think there is a huge shift as far as when I look at the Indian position is concerned. But again, removing some of the political and institutional hurdles, the bureaucratic hurdles, would require a little bit more push from the political leadership. Otherwise, we are going to be stuck at, like you said, framing nice joint statements, but we need to go seriously beyond that. We are, I think, making the right steps, right moves, but I think we still need to see some change. I keep saying this, India is like, the best example is that, like, it's an elephant. When it makes a move, maybe it makes an impact, but it takes a long time. And India being a democracy, and a loud and chaotic democracy, sometimes these hurdles can be hampering the pace of the Quad also.
Well, I think there's lots to be said for loud and messy democracies. Vindu, maybe could I turn to you for just some your thoughts on how we operationalize this in a practical way?
Sure. Thank you very much. And thank you, Raji, for those comments, because I think, you know, there's always this joke between India and Japan about how our bureaucracies are so bureaucratic and surrounded by red tape. So I do echo a lot of her sentiments regarding how difficult it is to maneuver with democracies that have stringent bureaucracies. So with regards to this, I wanted to do two things for this question. One is I did want to highlight a certain aspect in Japan regarding the bureaucratic red tape. So for example, when we look at the Quad, we understand quite quickly that there is this bureaucratic red tape around it. And when we look at Japan's position domestically, I think depending on which department we talk about, the Quad can be viewed fundamentally as a maritime concept. So for example, the Japanese Maritime Self-Defense Forces will view it quite similar to the US Navy, and their shared view largely represents that of, say, the US-Japan defense sector. However, when we look at Japan's Ministry of Economy and Trade and Industry, Meiti, which is a very powerful bureaucratic organization, or that of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, we see them ceding more space or being able to kind of chart out a vision for Chinese inclusivity in their discussions. So I think this could cause a hindrance, and it also causes an issue because I think there is a strong conversation between the Quad states in kind of how do we deal with China. And I think this requires, you know, to be dealt with much faster, but can they go much faster? You know, I think there is a certain amount of pace we need to be able to take into account. So that was the one thing I wanted to share with regards to the complexities within the Japanese bureaucratic system that could impact the Quad. The second thing was more of a question and a comment, and I would be happy to have a bit more discussion on this, because this is from my understanding as well, was when I study the Quad, I see that Australia has a Track 2 initiative supported by Australia's Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade called the Quad Tech Network. This is the Quad at the moment. But when I look back and study, you know, the second lull between 2013 and 17, we see a Track 1.5 coming in the form of a Quad Plus dialogue and then quickly moving, you know, to 2014, 15, 16. And we see this taking place between think tanks. I think at that time it was Jaya, the Heritage Foundation, Vivekanand, and ASPI in Australia. But what this dialogue, I think, was important in doing was keeping alive the discussion of the Quad while there was that entire lull. So when I look at this now in terms of, you know, this reinvigorated 2020-21 years in terms of the Quad, I see a Track 2 initiative. I also see working groups, and there are various working groups in the Quad on climate change, on 5G, on space, and then there's the Quad Vaccine Experts Group. I'm a little confused, especially when I went through, you know, all the government, the archive, the data, on the government websites to understand really what is the difference between a working group and, say, a Track 1.5. So are we creating working groups separately to have these bigger conversations and more frequent conversations on climate change and 5G and how they contribute to the Quad? Or is it more beneficial to have track 1.5. So we have a more expansive scope of inclusivity. So I think this is something I wasn't sure of, and maybe if anyone has an answer on this, I would be keen to hear that. But so between my comment on Japan's bureaucracy and this, I will stop here.
Well, that's great, Vindu. Thank you so much. And I think we have the right people in the room to provide an answer to your question, I suspect. Toby, seeing as it struck on DFAT's dialogues that it's been supporting, are you able to provide some clarity to Vindu and maybe also just offer your thoughts on how we take this from a leader statements and how translate that activity that you talked about into practical pathways forward?
Sure, absolutely. Let me see if I can do justice to all of those issues. Where do I begin? Let me just start firstly with a statement about myself. It's often been said that I'm not a particularly patient person and that I should work hard on that. But actually, genuinely, again, I'll restate, in terms of the quad, impatience hasn't been an issue. It's can you keep up with everything that's going on and the kind of drive that is in our systems and coming from our leadership down. So, you know, nobody should be under any illusions that this is some kind of, you know, talk shop and a nice statement that's come out of the end. And, you know, the very fact that there are working groups there, that is our government-to-government engagement between the Quad. Those working groups are structured to provide the government content that will be taken forward. 1.5 track, I don't need to explain to everyone what that is, but that, you know, increases the inclusivity, as Tarun was talking about. We know that we cannot solve these issues alone as government. We're not going to have the solutions. The tech providers have got to be part of that conversation. We've already done that around 5G telecommunications, and I think, you know, that's the way that we're going to get this moving forward. So when you mentioned the Quad Tech Network, that was an initiative that we partially helped fund, which is between some institutes from Quad members, GRIPS in Japan, the Observer Research Foundation, the Australian National University, and CNAS in DC. And to be frank, it was to stimulate ideas and thinking. And actually, the predominant outputs from that grouping have been thought pieces on trying to push the envelope of thinking inside government. You know, that's having come from a while ago now from a think tank background, that's the sweet spot of think tanks. If you can push government thinking hard, it's really helpful when you're on the inside. And that was the logic. And actually, if you look back to some of those papers that were released in the early stages of the QTN, they're really, you know, finger on the pulse of where you're seeing things move, and very informative. Obviously, you don't take all the ideas, but some of them, excellent thinking, just to stimulate the discussion. And I think that's where you'll see the Quad increasingly move to ensure that we're getting the traction that we need, is by bringing in more tech partners, more industry partners, more think tanks to start feeding that cycle more and more. Now, if you're looking for results, if you like, I mean, we've used the example of the standards working group, where our officials are meeting regularly, discussing, if you like, key milestones that they need to meet to show delivery. So, you know, and a good example would be, well, you know, we need to look at the ITU plenipotentiary next year and look at some of the key areas of standards development that they will be working on during that 3-week-long meeting, and ensure that we have tuned our processes of engagement and what our objectives are to a point that we get good outcomes through that meeting. And I think, you know, you'll see that through a succession of these working groups, that they will have, you know, specific issues that they're going to address. I mean, I, as you can tell, I'm pretty positive about this. You know, it's when you look at what is now coming out of the Quad, again, I say to people, you know, sometimes you do see statements and you think, oh, right, that's a statement with nothing beneath it. There is an architecture that's being built very rapidly underneath this. And I've seen all four bureaucracies move incredibly quickly to make sure that we got to this point and that we can take that further in a practical sense as well.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Toby.
Jordan, could I maybe just get your perspective from DC about how we take this forward and any sort of thoughts you maybe have on the CSIS paper and other sort of on-point fire-track processes that are working on this?
Yeah, thanks, Fergus. Yeah, I want to, you know, add to Toby's compliments my own for all the work that I think really laid the foundation for what we've been able to do over the last several months. It didn't just come out of the ether. I think it really did. It not only generated good ideas, it built a community of people who had already thought about, you know, areas where we might have stumbled, areas where we could proceed more quickly. And so we're really in debt to, I think, all of that work that was done. To your kind of question in this segment, really about, you know, overcoming kind of obstacles, you know, I think about it as both as principles, you know, standards, and then leadership. So, you know, at the level of principles, you know, again, to be one of our resident cheerleaders here, again, I was in the think tank world, you know, last year, and if you had told me, to Raji's point a moment ago, that we would be able to agree on this statement of principles on technology, design, development, governance, I would not have believed you, given everything that's in here. So I think that provides a really important framework for us to then get into kind of more specific questions about obstacles and bureaucratic hurdles with that really important foundation. I see our work on technical standards is trying to future-proof against some of this, right? So the idea is that this doesn't necessarily mean that we converge 100%, right, in our approach. What it means, though, is that we are coordinating very effectively, right? We are avoiding outcomes we don't want to see, and we ensure that we have compatibility and interoperability, right? That's really crucial. And we try to ensure that it's not just amongst thought that we have agreement on approaches to these standards, but that we have agreement in a much broader community of like-minded countries as well, right? That's really crucial. And then finally, you know, and I think both Toby and Raji alluded to this, the leadership dimension really can't be understated. The fact that we have heads of states saying to us, go deliver, 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 who are skeptical of statements alone inherently because they've been around this for a long time. They know what their bureaucracies are very good at doing. Really, again, cannot be understated because they want results. They want to see delivery. They want to know what concretely can be expressed in two sentences in a political context that makes sense to people who don't really follow this at all on a regular basis. And that really, I think, is going to be a driver in helping us overcome challenges along the lines of what you've put to us.
Thank you so much. I was going to maybe try and blend. We've got a question from the audience, which is fantastic. Please keep them coming in. And the question was, can the Quad offer alternatives to China's surveillance tech? And what really struck me about the Quad principles statement, it was in the first sentence, even the focus on developing technology that had democratic human values and universal human rights baked into it. And when I started out in this space, the sort of cliche was that everyone threw around was that technology was values agnostic. It would depend on the user, and you could use it for either good or bad, and it didn't really, the technology itself didn't really care about those things. But this seems almost, it's 180 degree turnaround on that sort of old school thinking on technology to sort of state so clearly that human rights and values really do matter. So if we go back to the question, can the Quad offer alternative to China's surveillance tech, and are we heading down this pathway as of a democratic technology and authoritarian technology? I don't know if anyone wants to jump in, volunteer for a hand up on that one. Toby?
I'm always going to go first. I think there is no avoiding the values discussion in technology anymore. And I know, you know, that statement that you made, Fergus, I think it's, it was the kind of perception in the past. I mean, I think it's true that technology very much reflects the society in which it's being used in. But there is a way, I think, that you can, and it's important, and this is certainly the Australian approach in our international cyber and critical tech engagement strategy. It's It's about what kind of values does Australia want to see technology embody, and also the way in which technology is absorbed into the global system. And those values are many of the values that are exemplified in the Quad statement. You know, we can talk to tech firms about the fact that, you know, they should be thinking about AI algorithmic programming and some of the potential biases that can come from certain algorithms and data sets. And so you can affect the technology cycle in that sense. And I think, you know, and Australia thinks that that is a vital part of this conversation. To your question of, you know, is it one or the other system that's going to win out? I don't think it's quite that simple. There's certainly competing visions of how technology is going to be used within societies, and then indeed is applied and used within different societies. But there are many shades in between those two sides as well. And I think that's why it's important to see statements like that the Quad have made, because it's, you know, it's not that each of the Quad members is, you know, a carbon copy of each other. We're all very different countries in our own way, but we can get to a point of common ground in the way that technology, you know, a set of principles on technology. Well, you know, I think that acts as a great example of flag raising that these are important issues for not just the Indo-Pacific region, but more broadly. And I think, you know, it's a discussion that's happening in Europe. Wherever you look now, that values discussion is taking place. So, you know, I'd agree with Tarun to the fact that we got to the point of having such a strong statement on values in technology, I think is a really important benchmark in the international system.
Just add a very quick point on that. So I think, I don't know if I have a direct response to that particular question, but the fact that the two Quad summits have put technology at the very center of the Quad engagement, everything from AI and semiconductor to cyberspace, outer space, critical supply chain, says a lot about the intention and the technology principles that were contained in the document. Again, says a lot about the need for the Quad countries, their intention to come together and address precisely. And this again comes in the backdrop of the increasing reality that multilateral institutions are failing us, especially in addressing the security and strategic ramifications of these fast-paced technologies. And in some sense, a failure or insufficiency of multilateral institutions to review and update the existing rules is an important agenda. It's an important factor for the Quad countries to take up the governance issue, in particular, how the technologies are being developed and designed and used. And I think that's so as to avoid the misuse and abuse of technology. So I think this is at the very core of the Quad agenda. This could become an active one in the coming months. But again, I am not giving a very direct answer to whether this is a response to or how it responds to the China's state tech surveillance, in a sense.
Well, I might take another question from the audience. The question is, and other panel members, if you want to jump in on the other question, please feel free to in this and combine your answers. But this question is, what's the way ahead for the Quad to develop a framework to combat misinformation online? Is there anyone that would like to take a first stab at that one? Vindu, is it? I see you jumping in there.
Well, I don't know if it would answer directly to the question of, you know, how do we deal with misinformation, but just, you know, stemming from what Raji had just said previously, I was just thinking more along the lines of, you know, the Quad could also, especially since it's made progress in terms of, you know, the working groups, especially the Quad Critical and Emerging Technology Working Group. I think what these groups can do and the different groups is that they could provide room to also be able to deal with how to smooth out differences between Quad states. So while this may not directly answer the question, for example, like when I look at, you know, the kind of different issues between Quad states, if I highlight an issue between, say, Japan and India, for example, Japan has been a strong proponent of the free flow of cross-border data. With government intervention for data privacy. And I think it was under Abe in 2019 at the G20 Osaka summit that Japan put in place this framework. And India, on the other hand, you know, recognizes the importance of international data transfer for cross-border business development, but has also reiterated that such discussions must be under the WTO framework, especially considering that data's emerging role as a new form of wealth. So I think, at least given the progress the Quad states have been making, given, you know, these working groups that have been put into place, while it may not directly answer the question, at least I feel there are mechanisms in place to in a more seamless way, deal with obstacles that Quad states between themselves would have on these issues. And hopefully through that, we could see a way to answer such kind of questions would be what I would add.
Does anyone else want to jump in on that one?
Fergus, I'll just say, as we all know, this addressing this particular challenge is one of the most complicated just inside our own countries. Put aside the question of international cooperation, right? Politically challenging, divisive at times, right, as to how to do this. And each of us has different constitutional regulatory approaches to free speech and so on and so forth. None of that stops us from obviously talking about common challenges and potential baseline issues. But I'll just say, you know, I think overall in addressing this issue, it's okay that it may require some time for us to internally within our own countries, build some consensus before we come to perhaps agreement within a Quad context. I have the privilege of also working in the U.S. EU Trade and Tech Council, and these kinds of issues come up as well in that context. So I'll just say I think the upside is that if we are focused and really committed to building this kind of architecture, that what we develop will truly be enduring. But at the same time, we won't be able to necessarily address every challenge right off the bat, right? I think there's been some discussion, for example, you know, certainly in the United States, of, you know, what can quote techno-democracies do to come together, right? I think sometimes that is so inclusive, it means everything. It means trade policy, it means addressing misinformation, everything under the sun, all of foreign policy, right? Just by calling ourselves techno-democracies, that doesn't mean that we're going to suddenly overcome all of these challenges. So I think what we're trying to do is kind of build this new architecture, be very practical but ambitious about what we can achieve in the near term, and then find ways to really coordinate wherever we can on challenges as daunting as this one.
We are coming up very close to our time here, but I just wanted to ask each of the panel members if they wanted to make a final statement, either just final, one minute summary of their view on the way ahead with the Quad, or alternatively, the one thing that we didn't talk about in the Quad, about the Quad that we should have talked about. Toby, maybe I can start with you.
Happily, look, I'm just going to just reflect on what Turan said, certainly at first, and say, you know, the Quad is doing a huge amount of work. It's not going to be the solution to everything. The Quad success will come from the binding of those four countries and seeing new and different ways of working together across the areas that we already have. And when potentially, you know, very important issues come up, how we can then use those existing mechanisms to work effectively on it. But I think it's, you know, as our Prime Minister has said, you know, the Quad is not an exclusive idea. It's an initiative to do positive things in the region and work with other partners who want to do the same. So, you know, it's really important to think of it in that broader sense as well. And you'll see in the joint statement, you know, Quad leaders confirm their strong support for the ASEAN centrality, ASEAN's outlook on the Indo-Pacific. It's not aiming to be all things to all people. And I think it's important also that everyone sees it in that context, that it's something that's complementary, stimulating even to other bodies to think about some of these issues too. And so I think just looking at it in that broader context is also important to realise that, you know, the Quad is not looking to be, as I say, all things to all people. It's a complementary mechanism, which I think is being pretty innovative in what it's doing right now.
Vindu, could I go to you?
Yeah, sure. Well, I do agree to a certain extent with Ambassador Fikin, but one of the things that I had a bit of a concern with is, especially for me, when I saw, you know, the inclusion of, you know, the denuclearization of the North Korean Peninsula and the abductee issue. So I thought that was a big win for the Japan government. But what does this mean in terms of, you know, the U.S.-North Korea talks that had happened in Singapore in 2018? If the Quad is not this kind of, you know, talking to everyone mechanism, I think there have been certain inclusions, including Myanmar, where one might wonder, and maybe it's because I'm not in the government and I'm just outside, but I do wonder, you know, at what point do we say that, how much is it doing where it's pushing too far? In the sense, there have been huge conversations about, you know, the denuclearization of the North, especially with South Korea, or how much is, you know, too ambitious in the sense that before it's viewed as a framework that's trying to do too much. And we have heard today by both Mr. Chhabra and Ambassador Fikin about how much an effort has gone in by all the governments to really get this going to the pace it's going. And that's just one of the concerns I had when I saw, you know, and in Northeast Asia, when an issue like that comes up, it always blows up a bit before it settles down. So that was one of the concerns that I had.
Thank you, Vindu. I think we have 1 minute left, so I might just go very quickly to Tarun, and then I'll hand to Raji, if that's okay, to wrap up.
Sure, just very briefly. Thanks so much to all of you for a great discussion today. I really just want to underscore again the point that Toby just made. You know, he underscored the mention of ASEAN. I would add to that in our statement of principles on technology, we very explicitly noted at the end of it that we welcome all nations to join us in pursuit of the shared vision for technologies, and, you know, guided by all of those principles. And that really does speak to the fact that we are trying to build, to the degree possible, an open architecture that engages other countries in the region and welcomes them into this. We've come a long way since in our initial call we couldn't figure out which digital platform to use to communicate with each other. So I'm grateful for those of you who are kind of pushing us to think about how we can both accelerate what we're doing and expand our agenda for the future. So thanks again.
Thank you very much, Raji, our host. Have you got a 30-second burst?
Thank you. No, I think a lot has been said, but I think I would just say that the Quad has a very, very clear, very proactive agenda. Maybe some would say ambitious agenda has been said, but I think it's time that we look long term and we look strategic and how we want to engage. And I think in that sense we have set ourselves in a good place. But I think it's also possible that we expand the Quad in the future to make a Quad Plus. There is already a Quad Plus in the context of health and vaccine diplomacy. But I think it's important that we also bring in other economically and technologically capable countries in the region, such as South Korea, Singapore, Indonesia, Taiwan, and so on and so forth, into this grouping. But I think if I have to just say in a couple of minutes, in a minute on what is driving India, and I think India has an invested interest in this. India has become an invested party in this. It's come a long way, but in terms of the normative exercise and in driving the technology development, design, and all of that, India has a long way and has significant interest in this regard. So I do see a very proactive and positive agenda driving the Quad into the future. We are democracies. There might be some slow patches, but I think we are still on a strong wicket. Let me stop there and thank you so much.
Raji, thank you for finishing up on such a positive note. A big virtual clap to our terrific panel today. Thank you so much for your time and joining us all around the world. And thank you to the audience for listening in and for SciFy for hosting this event. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you very much. And I look forward to seeing you all again soon.
Thank you.